Hi. So in the last video, we talked about policing in America and how it's changed over time and all the different factors, or some of the factors that have caused it to change over time, thereby altering the character of local governments and therefore communities in the U.S. I was online the other day and I heard a joke about the United States. And it goes like this. The United States is the greatest country in the world for people who haven't traveled much. And the comedian who I think was actually born on a U.S. military base in Germany, I'm not 100% sure about that. He then mentioned New Zealand. He said, you know, New Zealand looks nice. You know why? And then he went on and so on. But I thought to myself that, you know, actually, if there's one country where there isn't really much of a comparison, where the United States would be considered to be a superpower or an ideal destination, it would be in comparison to a tiny country in the middle of nowhere. But then I got to thinking, and I realized that when you're judging a country, too often we're judging that country based on our own specific circumstances. We're not judging it from a more fair analysis, or an analysis that focuses on justice. What we're focusing on is typically, I've been successful in this particular city or country, and therefore the country is better than some other place where I probably would not have been as successful because either of the lack of openness or similar economic openness or so on and so forth. But if you actually think about the comparison between New Zealand and the US, you can do it. You can do an analysis based on what's called the veil of ignorance. And I've talked about this before, but ultimately, if you didn't know which city you'd be born in, what color you'd be, whether you'd be an immigrant, a refugee, or a citizen, or anything else, whether your parents would have a PhD, or simply, you know, high school diploma, when you do it that way, when you consider the equation that way, you suddenly start to realize that you can't figure out whether or not you would be the descendant of slaves in America. And you can't figure out if, as a result, that you would be at a disadvantage economically compared to your neighbors. In that case, New Zealand suddenly starts to look at least equal to the United States as a destination. And I'm not suggesting that this is the only way to look at the issue. I'm not suggesting that this is the primary way to judge whether or not a country is successful, but it's certainly one way. And of course, New Zealand has an issue with the Maori population. And when you start to look at the all of the Western countries, it does seem as if a lot of the success has been based on essentially importing cheap labor, whether it's Chinese, whether it's slavery from the west coast of Africa, or whatnot. And when you look at it that way, suddenly the country's success doesn't look as fair or as progressive as it should be. It begins to look a little bit as if New Zealand has a chance at competing with a country that on paper should be almost infinitely better in every way. And again, you can see how over time progressives have failed. Because if you can create an argument that your background in America, if it was randomized, would allow a small country, an almost insignificant country, like New Zealand, from being able to attract people under a fair system. Number one, you see why people want to maintain the status quo. And you also hopefully should be able to see why people want to change the status quo, so that it won't be a joke, that nobody will one day be able to compare a tiny country in the middle of nowhere to the United States, a so-called superpower. And so when you look at all these issues, in context. You realize, by the way, that's why politicians matter, because they're supposed to put things in context for you, given that they have better access to information. Not only because of surveillance technology, but because of this idea that if you are a trusted representative of the people, you are going to get information more than somebody who wakes up at 7 a.m., drives an hour to work, and comes home to his or her family at 7 p.m., eats dinner, watches a movie, you know, says goodnight to his children or her children, and sleeps. The idea really has been that the politicians are important because they offer, they're part of the glue that binds society together in ways that allow us to progress. And it's hard to be an American today, because you start to realize that we haven't quite progressed from a lot of the issues that should have been resolved by now. And it's not just the United States. You'll notice very quickly that almost all of the Americas, anywhere that speaks Spanish in the Western Hemisphere, has similar issues regarding the racial component. And if you're really a student of history, you'll start to realize why that's the case. But you'll also, you shouldn't stop there, because the whole history of the Western Hemisphere has been the Protestants and the Catholics, both white for the most part, segregating themselves in order to create essentially parallel structures. And of course, the Protestants believed that they were justified in doing this, including when they had political power in banning the Catholic Church back in the day. None of the founders of the United States were Catholic. There's a reason for that. And of course, the reason is that the Protestants were driven out based on, for many, many centuries, out of Europe. And of course, you know, they got their revenge. And at that point, after the Protestants came here, they ended up getting power in Europe. And then the Catholics, it was the Catholics' time to come back to the United States. So the Catholic Empire essentially moved from Rome to Germany, Saxony, and that's where you had the Protestant Reformation. Again, not a coincidence, right? And now it's moved over to the United States and consolidated power here. The reason we don't see within our lifetimes a high prospect of a civil war is because of the fact that the Protestants and the Catholics have basically balkanized government spending, especially within police departments, all over the U.S., and have created by the abortion issue, have created a wedge, a way to separate voters from each other, and in doing so, focus government power and government spending, and therefore successful outcomes, based on segregation. And the communities where minorities have been the most successful have also been segregated. Not a coincidence, the most successful Arab American community in the United States is in Dearborn, Michigan, majority Arab. So you can argue that democracy calls for segregation in order to protect minority growth. And you can also start to see that within that kind of a system where you don't have politicians acting on behalf of everyone in conjunction with all the stakeholders, you can also see how over time, you can just see how over time it all falls apart and how communication becomes more and more difficult. And that's really the history of the United States that they don't really teach you here. And it's tempting to see no prospect of a civil war simply because if you keep communities apart from each other under this Western system post-World War II of not necessarily divide and conquer, but divide and govern. In other words, you split up Israel and Palestine into different religious communities. You split up India and Pakistan into different religious communities. You split up Malaysia and Singapore into Muslim versus Chinese communities. All over the world, more recently, you split up South Sudan and Sudan into Catholic versus non-Catholic communities. Czechoslovakia is now Czechia and Slovakia because the Catholics took over Slovakia side. Even Václav Havel, the greatest Christian thinker perhaps of the 20th century, was unable to keep Czechoslovakia together. That's how great these forces that have decided that governance requires splitting people up in order to allocate government funding properly. That's how powerful these forces are. And until we openly acknowledge it, we're going to be in for a reckoning someday. Probably not soon, because as long as you can print money, you know, everything seems as if it's still glued together, even as citizens, depending on where they are, lose faith in their police departments, in their politicians, and so on. Now, as a libertarian, you have to sort of ask yourself, you know, why do you care? Don't you want a smaller government? The idea behind a smaller government is a more effective government and more effective solutions that are not based on one religion or one ethnic group taking over and then segregating each people and voters based on external issues like abortion or moral issues that allow district funding, corporate funding, and so on, that allow segregation to happen so easily. And the one thing the United States desperately needs right now is a third party to keep these two, the Republicans and the Democrats, in check. But more so than that, it just needs a third party to create an honest voice in America. Because there really are none anymore, not on the national level. And that, of course, based on the funding and funding fluctuations since, you know, 2008, 2009, has essentially infected governance all across the country. And again, because this country is so large and the population relatively small, it's not something that is immediately obvious. And again, we're not going to have a civil war within my lifetime, but this is obviously something that has to be fixed. And the way to fix it, one way, would be to have a legitimate third party. And that's nowhere on the horizon. You would think that more than 3% of the population would have voted for a third party in the last election. But the voting districts are now so segregated that they didn't even manage to break that 5% cap that would have allowed a third party to have independent funding. That's how much segregation has already cemented right now with a small population relative to the landmass. And so what you're going to see over time are more attempts to inflate asset values in order to keep all this together. But of course, if the status quo is based on segregation and a deliberate policy post-World War II to segregate based on religion and ethnicity, which in and of itself was based on another policy to import cheap labor and to underpay cheap labor as much as possible, all the way down to slavery, you can see how racism, right, would be required to justify all this. And of course, Thomas Jefferson wrote on the topic of slavery, "I tremble for my country when I realize that God is just." In other words, the founders knew what they were doing was wrong, but even they couldn't distance themselves from economic headwinds and from having to flee essentially persecution by consolidated actors. And what we're seeing now here with this new package coming out of the federal government that will give about $350 billion to local governments, along with another separate package before that gave billions to private actors, especially real estate owners, what you're going to see now is a consolidation overall of all of this, and the question, without any sort of solution in sight, because of the lack of an independent voice that is able to reach both sides equally well.